Very good morning, guys. How are you all?
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. I hope you all doing good.
All
so,
good, sir. Yes.
Whose presentation is this today?
Sam.
Sam?
Yes, sir.
Sam, I think you can share your presentation and you can start. सैम मेरी आवाज आ रही
है? यस सर, जस्ट अपलोडिंग द प्रेजेंटेशन.
Yes, Sam, it's visible.
Okay, sir. So I'm starting. The topic is organic composting. And organic composting is the process of breaking down of biodegradable organic waste to produce stable, nutrient-rich compost through natural exothermic process of aerobic decomposition. So compost is a product of recycling processes, and it is a very appropriate input material for organic farming, given that it is well managed and the input material are free of contaminants and the resulting product.
Sam, could you turn on your camera as well?
Okay, sir. Yeah. Sam, are you visible?
Yes, you are.
So compost, and the resulting product is applied according to the need of the system's ecological needs. So the next is compost. So compost is natural decomposition process in the soil, can be regulated and speeded up by man, and the organic material is collected and preferably stacked in a heap. And in the heap, the decomposition process is more intensive and the conditions are favorable. So the heap is made because the heap is made up entirely of organic material. And the end product, which is a strongly decayed organic matter, which contains humus and nutrients, is known as compost. And it can be used as an organic fertilizer to the soil. So the requirements of a compost, first is obviously the organic material. And in general, any organic material of plants and animals can be used, but we have to maintain an ratio, carbon to nitrogen ratio of 25:1. So younger and sappy materials, which are easily decomposable, have a high content of nitrogen and less of carbon, whereas old and tough materials like twigs, barks and branches would contain more of the carbon material and less of nitrogen. So we have to maintain this 25:1 ratio, otherwise, like, if there is less carbon, then the microorganism would get less energy, and if there is less nitrogen, the micro or the decomposition process would be slow, and if there is a high amount of nitrogen, then the compost would get acidic and would give an smelly and give an odor. So the next is we should also be careful not to use toxic materials, like the plant parts which are using for organic material, which are using for compost, should not be have pesticides and other chemicals, because this could have an adverse effect on the quality of the compost as well as the decomposition process. So next is microorganisms. The first condition for decomposing would need presence of decomposing organisms. So this can be done by adding a ready-made compost, and if it's not possible, if we don't have any ready-made compost, then soil collected from shady places, from like under a tree, shade of the tree, where there is moisture content to contain a lot of microorganisms that could help in decomposing. So I'll talk about actinomycetes, which is a bacteria, but it has a different nutritional requirement than other bacteria. So they can degrade more complex molecules such as lignin and hemicellulose easily. And there are other levels of the first level of decomposers usually has actinomycetes, bacteria, and fungi. And the second level would have termites and the second level would have protozoas and nematodes. And the third level would have a higher soil fauna like ants and termites. And the next is air, and obviously microorganisms require oxygen to survive and do their work converting the organic material into compost. And the carbon in this process, carbon dioxide is also formed, and which has to be regulated out through airflow. And if there is not enough airflow or enough air in the heap, then the microorganism that we need would not survive, because this is an aerobic process. So in turn, the microorganisms that do not need oxygen would thrive, and decomposition would be slowed down. And this type of transformation will also lead to incomplete oxidation of the compounds to carbon monoxide, water, and heat. And there are also chances of the organic compounds to be turned into volatile fatty acids, which could which would make the compost phytotoxic and also create bad odor. So in order to get enough air in the compost, we need to add twigs and other rough materials like branches and all, which could create some air pockets. Or we can also use stakes, like we could perpendicularly push upright the stakes and bundle of twigs in upright form position, so that when we remove it, there would be air pockets. Then next is some moisture, and moisture usually organism need moisture to live and spread to the heap, and the activity of organism would slow down if there is if the heap is too dry. And if the heap is too wet, then the high moisture content would make diffusion of oxygen to deeper parts of the pile difficult. This results in oxygen depletion. So moisture content of 30% is recommended as minimum, but 45 to 55 would be the optimum during the thermophilic stage. The we can test moisture by basically inserting a bundle of straw in the heap, and if after 5 minutes the bundle feels clammy, so then the moisture content is good. If it is too dry, then we need to sprinkle a bit of water, and if it's too wet, then it's we can place the compost in the sun to dry it out. And
last, for testing the temperature,
this is a moisture content, if there is for moisture. So can I move on?
Yes.
Okay, the next is site of the compost heap. So the climate does matter, because if the temperature is too hot, it would be preferred to be kept in a shady place. The transport also matters, because from where you're getting the input material and also from where you're giving the compost should not be too far, because the compost is a heavy material and the transport charges could be too high. Then vermin. So the compost could attract a lot of rats and other vermin. So this would also in turn attract their predators like snakes and all, which could be dangerous for the personnel working there. Space around the heap also matters, because in some of the processes that methods we're going to learn in that, we need to turn over the heap, and this would require a large amount of area near it. Also, like the heap should not be near hospitals or some school places, where there are chances of the heap to get to not give a good proper compost and could release bad odor, which could be troublesome for the people living there. Next is the composting process. So there are three phases of a composting process. that is heating phase, or also known as fermentation. So this is the first stage of compost, and the compost heap starts to heat up considerably. This is called as fermentation. And in this process, the breakdown of the organic material starts, and it is most strongest in the center of the heap. So the factors that influence heating phase would be the organic material that we are using, the amount of microorganisms we have, and if there is adequate oxygen and water supply. When these three conditions are optimal, the heat is generated quickly. Also, another benefit to this increase in temperature is that the pathogenic germs which are harmful for man, animal, or even plants are destroyed, and it sometimes also kills weed seeds. We have the temperature test, which is the dipstick test, and we can dip a stick in the center of the heap for about 5 to 10 minutes after 5 days of completing the heap or the final turning over. So if the heap the stick feels warm after 5 to 10 minutes, then it is a kind of the op- it is or the temperature is optimal. But if the stick is too cold, then there is some there is some issue with the material used, or the aeration is at fault. So next is the cooling down phase, and in cooling down phase, the fermentation after the fermentation phase gradually changes into cooling down phase. And this decomposition occurs without much generation of heat, and the temperature drops slowly. And you can also regulate the temperature. You can also regulate this process by adjusting the temperature and water supply. So depending on how you want the process to be accelerated or slowed down, you can change the the factors. So the next is the maturation phase. And this is the end phase of the decomposition, where the temperature drops to the soil temperature depending on the climate, which is around 15 to 25 degrees Celsius. And apart from the microorganisms that were involved, the large soil fauna, like I discussed about the third level decomposers, are also active at this stage. And in temperate regions, the earthworms usually feed on the strongly decomposed material. Whereas in tropic to semi-arid regions, termites play an important role, whereas termites can also be quite troublesome. So this phase never actually comes to an end, because the decomposition process takes on infinitely at a slow rate. But the compost is ready when it feels crumbly and has a brown to a black soil, organic soil like color. So next is the method. So I'm just going to discuss three methods.
I think you can skip this, Sam.
Okay, sir.
You can come to the research article.
Okay. My research was on basically how composting helps to prevent antibiotic resistant gene. So I'll move on. So high levels of residual antibiotics.
Please just go back. Just a second. Okay. Carry on.
Alright, so many bacteria in the environment naturally carry antibiotic resistant genes, probably as defense against antibiotics produced by some soil fungi and bacteria. And antibiotics are a class of medicines extensively used in promoting growth and yield, as well as controlling diseases in livestock and poultry farms. So around 30 to 90% of this administered antibiotics are excreted through urine and manures. And leading to accumulation of residual antibiotics in the livestock environment. So this manure is also used. So this high levels of residual antibiotics and manure provide a selective pressure to the microbial communities, which could acquire antibiotic resistant genes through horizontal gene transfer or spontaneous mutation, therefore creates causing a proliferation, which is the increase of increase in number of resistant bacteria. So due to this application of organic fertilizers in agriculture, the in increasing diversity and abundance of antibiotic resistant genes, they pose a potential threat to human health and environmental safety. So the sample which was collected was from in China, Shandong province, and cow dung, chicken manure, sheep manure, and earthworm cast was used, and they were actually composted through the CDC stands for cow dung compost, and CDU stands for cow dung uncomposted. So they were stored at minus 20 degrees Celsius for antibiotic concentration determination. So DNA was extracted and PCR was done through quantification PC polymerase chain reaction. So I'll move on to the result. And if you see the chart here, you can see the uncomposted, the CMU, ECU, CDU, and SMU.
Sam?
Yes, sir.
Sam, ek bar piche jana. Ye qPCR kya hai? To obtain the total bacterial abundances.
Yes, sir. It is a quantitative PCR. How they use qPCR? So, sir, it is actually amplification of the bacteria, because so that they use it to get the then they test it on the genes.
That is fine, but how did they obtain bacterial abundances?
So from the compost. The compost.
I am getting it. That is fine. I am asking that they have used real time quantitative PCR. They have used. In order to obtain bacterial abundance, so say there are 5 type of bacteria or 10 type of bacteria, and then through qPCR it won't be able to obtain in a single go to obtain all the bacterial abundance.
So obviously there were different, I guess they used different methods to isolate the bacteria, like streaking methods and all, then tested on them. And then after the PCR,
we come to it later, Sam. You can continue with the paper part.
So the result was that the uncomposted, even if you see this chart, the uncomposted show a higher amount of antibiotic resistant genes compared to the composted. So obviously the composted material didn't completely remove the antibiotic resistant genes, but there were less amount of antibiotic resistance gene present in them. So detected antibiotic resistance could potentially confer resistance to a lot of major antibiotics like aminoglycoside, beta-lactam. Beta-lactam is used in penicillin and other drugs, and even some last resort life-saving drugs like the vancomycin. So this result indicated that antibiotic resistance genes are exists widely in the organic fertilizers, and manure application not only adds nutrients and organic matter to the cultivated soil for growth, but also introduces antibiotic resistant genes, posing a potential risk to human health. So by composting, we can reduce this chance. And even though they haven't explained the mechanism behind how composting actually helps in reducing the amount of antibiotic resistant genes, this has still been studied. But this has shown an important advantage of using composting instead of directly using the manure. Yes, so that's the end of my slide.
In your paper, they have tried and tested. They have extracted the bacteria, those who actually had resistance to many of the antibiotics. So they say that this composting, it can reduce the antibiotic content residue in the fertilizers. Yahi baat batana cha rahe ho, Sam?
Sir, actually, the baat ye hai ki the microbial communities in the environment, right? They obtain the antibiotic resistant genes because of the antibiotic setup present in the excreta. Mm-hmm. So due to this, they obviously the microorganism would grow in that compost also. So the genes, when tested in when grown in those who were grown in manure, were turned out to be having more antibiotic resistant genes, as those who were composted had less number of antibiotic resistant genes.
That is fine. Sam, my question is that would it actually affect the, is it good that antibiotic resistance genes are coming up in these bacteria?
So obviously it's not good. That's why we are saying that we have to use composted methods, because composted methods would have less number of antibiotic resistant genes. And I wish they could come up with a method that would eliminate...
Sam, I couldn't get your point. You are saying that from the compost they have taken out the... this bacterial load, fine. And then they have sequenced it to see that they already have the antibiotic resistance genes.
Oh, okay, sir. I see. So if you see this table, you can see that the CMU, which is chicken manure uncomposted, has a higher number, like around 180 antibiotic resistant genes, different type of antibiotics. Whereas the CMC, which has around 85 to 90, which is the composted of the chicken manure. So if you see this, even in earthworm cast, all of them has the uncomposted has higher number of antibiotic resistant genes compared having a higher number of antibiotic resistant genes, which could are a potential threat to humans, cause we would need more antibiotics to treat them.
So
they're saying that it's better to use composted because they have less number of antibiotic resistant genes. The antibiotic resistance is present in both of them, but there are higher chances of having antibiotic resistance, like there are higher number in uncomposted manure. So to prevent this, because even from one antibiotic, it could mutate to others. So that would pose a threat because not all of them would have the same strain, right? So it's better to use composted because they reduce the chances of having more number of antibiotic resistant genes.
Fine. Questions from the students, Adhish, Athoyba, Yushi, kisi ka sawal hai? Ayushi has a question. Ayushi?
Yes, sir. Sir, am I audible?
It would be good if you can turn on your camera. Yes, you are clearly audible though.
Sam, when you were talking about compost, you said that the natural decomposition, it can be regulated and speeded up by the man. So can you explain how can we speed up the decomposition process?
Okay, so decomposition is actually a natural process that happens in the environment all the time. But as I explained, these requirements that are needed, like the organic material plays an important role in the compost and the microorganisms used, because the microorganisms which have a higher metabolism rate could decompose faster. Then obviously you need air and moisture, which in optimal amounts would enhance the growth of microorganisms. And yeah, so these factors would fasten up the process of compost.
Ayushi, is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Tanvi?
Yes, sir. So, Sam, like organic yields are usually below the conventional yields, and with the growing population, the demand for food is also increasing. So, what do you think about claims such as organic farming is the future?
Okay, so other than using compost, like organic compost, we can use inorganic fertilizers, which have an advantage of like the application time is really less. Like the moment you apply fertilizers, the plant intakes the nutrients, but in the long run, it degrades the soil, and it would also create a lot of other adverse effects. Also, in conventional methods, we usually use pesticides, DDT being an example, And biomagnification is a process in which small amount of DNA they get added up and
amplified. Yes.
So they would end up creating osteoporosis in birds and even humans. So when compared, and obviously at, if we talk about manure, then I've told already about the antibiotic resistant genes. So in the broad spectrum, we can see that organic compost does help in the long run.
Thank you, sir.
Good understanding, good. Sanjana?
Okay, Sam, in the research paper that you explained, that was about like how ARDs in different types of organic fertilizers treated with and without composting were examined. And in the last, it was concluded that composting can significantly reduce the antibiotic residues in organic fertilizers. So my question is that how and why composting reduced the ARDs in organic fertilizers?
Okay, so the research paper obviously had no clear-cut answer on the mechanism of how it works, but I think the temperature increase, the thermophilic, the first stage in which the temperature increases, reduces the number of pathogens in the compost. So with reduce of number of population of bacteria, there is also going to be reduce in the number of population growth, which would reduce the chances of reducing the horizontal gene transfer or spontaneous mutation. So I guess this could be an reason why there is less number of antibiotic resistant genes present in the composted organic compost.
Any other reason, Sam?
Sir, actually, there is no clear-cut mechanism for that, but I think that this could be one reason.
Won't it depend upon the substrate that you were using for the bacteria to feed upon?
Yes.
What they have compared is
also the
Mara, in the graph, you in the results section, you had clearly shown that how the material it affects the growth of the microorganisms and how bad bacteria or good bacteria they are coming up.
Yes.
Second is that it depends that what fodder you are providing to the good bacteria. If good bacteria, they emerge to grow at that time, obviously their population will come up.
Yes, sir.
So that is an answer to it. But yes, the mechanism was not there entirely explained. Vivek?
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you were audible.
Am I visible, sir?
No, not visible though.
Sir, may I go ahead and ask the question anyways?
Okay.
I just wanted to know, is there any scenario where we might be able to use diseased material in our compost? Can we use diseased material in our compost?
Okay, so by diseased material, we use compost for plants, right? So if you're using something that would be harmful to plants, then I don't think that makes sense in using that. And if it's not harmful to plants, that it infects humans, then again it's not going to make sense for we are going to use that plant material which would be infected with microbes that could infect humans. So I don't think there is any common sense. There is no way of there is no need to use microbes that could harm either the plants or humans.
Thank you, Sam.
Okay, Sam. Any other, anybody else for the question? Or I think we should switch to...
I have a question.
Who is there?
Actually, I raised my hand, but it's not working.
Yeah, okay.
Sam, in composting process, we can control most of the parameters like the acidity of the soil, the moisture content, but we cannot control the temperature, right? So which is a huge factor that determines the resulting compost will be good one or not. So is there any way by which
the temperature could be too less or could be too high, and depending upon that, like if it's too high, then it's it's advisable to use to place the compost in a shady place and add a bit of moisture.
Yeah, that is the way by which the temperature can actually be controlled.
If it's too cold, then you can place it in the sun. And you can also add a bit of microorganisms, because when microorganisms would replicate, reproduce, they would also increase the temperature of the compost. Yeah. And then I think you should also check the moisture content and the aeration levels, because they also are important factors in the temperature of a compost.
Well, fine, Yukta, he had tried to answer it, but I think we should move forward to have another presentation by Tridev. Tridev?
I'm just uploading my presentation.
Okay.
So is it visible?
Yes, it's visible. Tridev, you can begin.
So the topic of my presentation is vermicomposting, and vermicomposting is a scientific process of making compost by using earthworms. They are commonly found living in the soil, feeding on biomass and excreting it in a digested form. Vermiculture means worm farming. Earthworms feed on the organic waste material and give out excreta in the form of vermicast that are rich in nitrates and minerals such as phosphorus, magnesium, calcium, and potassium. These are used as fertilizers and enhance soil quality. Vermicomposting comprises of two methods basically. One is the bed method and this pit method. Bed method is a very easy method in which beds of organic matters are prepared, and pit method is a method in which the organic matter is collected in cemented pits. However, the method is not prominent as it involves problems of poor aeration and water logging. Vermicomposting is regarded as a clean, sustainable, and zero waste approach to manage organic waste, but there are still some constraints in the popularizations of vermicomposting. Maintaining a continuous supply of organic waste, water, temperature, and moisture are major hurdles that complicate the process of vermicomposting. Now coming to the process of vermicomposting. To prepare a vermicompost using earthworms and other biodegradable waste is the aim. Principle, this process is the soil. Compost is a natural fertilizer that allows an easy flow of water to growing plants. The earthworms are mainly used in this process as they eat on the organic matter to produce more through the digestive enzymes. Systems. The nutrients profile of vermicompost are 1.6% of nitrogen, 0.7% of phosphorus, 0.8% of potassium, 0.5% of calcium, 0.2% of magnesium, 175 ppm of iron, and 96.5 ppm of manganese, and 24.5 ppm of zinc. Materials required are farm waste, cow dung, thatch roof, earthworms, gunny bags, wheat biomass, I'm coming to the procedure. To prepare a compost, either a plastic or a concrete tank can be used. The size of the tank depends on the availability of raw materials. Collect the biomass and prepare it under the sun for about 8 to 12 days. Now chop it to the required size using the cutter. Prepare a cow dung slurry and sprinkle it over the heap for quick decomposition. Add a layer 2 to 3 inch of soil and or sand at the bottom of the tank. Now prepare fine bedding by adding partially decomposed cow dung, dried leaves and other biodegradable waste collected from fields and kitchen. Continue adding both the chopped bio waste and partially decomposed cow dung layer into the tank up to the depth of 0.5 to 1 feet. After adding all the bio waste, release the earthworm species over the mixture and cover the compost mixture with dry straw or gunny bags. Sprinkle water on a regular basis to maintain the moisture content of the compost. Cover the tank with a thatch roof to prevent the entry of ants, lizards, mouse, snakes, etc. and protect the compost from rainwater and direct sunshine. Have a frequent check to avoid the compost from overheating. Maintain proper moisture and temperature. Earthworm converting domestic and food industry waste into biofertilizers. Vermicomposting is a eco-biotechnological process that employs earthworms in the process of decomposition of organic matter. Now taking into account the pro-environmental politics worldwide, it may be considered an interesting eco-innovation in bio-waste treatment. Thus, it fits perfectly in the circular economy concept. Transferring the different types of organic waste, such as domestic and industrial waste, there are into renewable energy sources or biosolids. It constitutes an alternative to other waste disposal techniques considered not to be environmentally friendly. But many different types of organic waste have been proposed as substrates in this process. For example, byproducts from different industrial branches. Some beneficial properties of vermicompost make it an interesting product for agricultural.
Can continue?
Yes. Yeah. Vermicompost also helps in solid waste management. Vermicompost is a complicated process than traditional processes. It can be make it clear, but generally requires more labor. It requires more space because worms are surface feeders and will not operate in materials more than a meter in depth. It is more vulnerable to environmental pressures such as temperature, freezing conditions and drought. Perhaps more importantly, it requires more startup resources, each in cash to buy the worms or in time to time and labor to grow them. Vermicompost has the following advantages over chemical fertilizers, and it's more preferable. It restores microbial population, which include nitrogen fixtures, phosphate solubilizers, etc. It provides major micronutrients to the plants. It provides soil texture and water holding capacity to the soil. It provides good aeration to the soil. It decreases the use of pesticides for controlling plant pathogens. It improves structural stability of the soil, thereby preventing soil erosion. It enhances the quality of grains, fruits to. Disadvantages are also there. It is a time-consuming process and can take up to 6 months to convert the organic matter into usable forms. It releases a good fuel or foul odor. Then, vermicomposting is high maintenance. The bin used not to be dry or too wet, the moisture level needs to be monitored periodically. They nurture the growth of pests and pathogens such as fruit flies. Vermicompost turns the kitchen waste and other green waste into dark, nutrient-rich soil. Due to presence of microorganism, it maintains a healthy soil. Now, coming to the conclusion, earthworms serve as the nature's plowman and nature's gift to produce good humus, which is... Yes, sir.
You have any paper that you have discussed?
Yes, sir. It's included in this, but I haven't mentioned it particularly. Like, I haven't taken a screenshot of it.
I cannot see anything from here.
Sir, I read a paper from Science Direct, and
which was... Would you just share the title?
Yes, sir. The title of the paper is Earthworms Converting the Domestic and Food Industry Waste into Biofertilizers, that is mentioned over here, and the Solid Waste Management paper. Like, there were two small papers. They were literally small papers.
But you could have shared it. I mean... These are not papers, these are review articles basically, and you have just taken up the part that was more associated with the vermicomposting process rather than any finding or anything else has been discussed.
Yes, sir.
Ye achha hota ki agar Tridev, you could have presented a research paper. I mean, मैं ये नहीं बोल रहा कि रिव्यू नहीं वो करना है, बट रिव्यू कुड हैव बीन वेरी एग्जॉस्टिव रिव्यू. आई मीन आई वाज नॉट एबल टू मेक आउट एनीथिंग दैट ओके द पेपर हैज बीन प्रेजेंटेड. ये तो ऐसे लग रहा है कि हम टेक्स्ट पढ़ रहे हैं और एक वही चीज़ है कि विच हैज बीन डन इन द क्लास. एनीथिंग न्यू लाइक सैम ही प्रेजेंटेड अ रिसर्च आर्टिकल, बट उसमें एक फाइंडिंग अच्छी थी कि हाउ द एंटीबायोटिक रेजिस्टेंस मैकेनिज्म्स दे आर कमिंग अप एंड the bacterial load. So could of that kind would have done the part. Anyways, Ridhav, aadha wo apni slide pe aage aadha.
Yeah, so sir, coming to the conclusion, earthworms serve as a nature's plowman and nature's gift to produce good humus, which is most precious material to fulfill the nutritional needs of crop. Vermicompost can be used for all crops, example agriculture, horticulture, ornamental and vegetable, at any stage of the crop. The utilization of vermicompost results in several benefits to farmers, industries, environments and overall national economy. A properly designed vermicast system will process organic waste into vermicast in 22 to 30 days. This process self-aerates and does not require mechanical aeration or mixing. Earthworm bedding, commonly used in the earthworm bins, can be replaced by screen or mesh raised bottom surfaces and enough finished vermicast. Adequate drainage and aeration prevents odor, flies or the migration of earthworms out of the waste. Vermicast can be done on a domestic farm or industrial scale in waste processing facilities and could be sited near residential areas, minimizing waste and fertilizer transportation costs when added to plants. Vermicast has been shown to improve resistance to diseases, yield and protein content to plant relative to other commercial fertilizers. That's it.
Sir, you are on mute.
यस सर।
किसी का कोई सवाल? Which would be better in agriculture, vermicompost or compost, Tridev?
Sir, it completely depends. Like in a vermicompost, it is a time consuming process, and like I have already mentioned it earlier, vermicompost has many good reasons to be taken, and there are similarly very bad. They have negative issues also.
But how you were saying that it is a time taking process? It's more faster than a normal compost.
But sir, it's a labor oriented process. Like it takes
labor
a lot of time. But
तुम बोल रहे हो कि it's slow process.
No, sir. Like in other sense, ki like it's a labor oriented and a lot of money oriented also process. Sir. So I would prefer.
Would it be automated, Tridev?
Vermicompost. So maybe.
एग्रीकल्चर यूज के लिए उसने बहुत ही अच्छा क्वेश्चन पूछा है. वर्मी कंपोस्ट इज ऑलवेज गुड. देर इज अ क्लियर डिफरेंस दैट वॉज बींग स्टेटेड वेन आई वॉज टीचिंग यू पीपल दैट वर्मी कंपोस्ट इज मोर रिच इन कंपेरिजन टू द नॉर्मल कंपोस्ट. दैट मेक्स अ वेरी क्लियर डिफरेंस. प्लस इट कैन बी ऑटोमेटेड. द कंटिन्यूस प्रोसेस कैन बी अचीव्ड इन वर्मी कंपोस्टिंग. आप अर्थवॉर्म्स अपने कुछ टाइम बाद दे रेप्लीकेट देमसेल्व्स, दे डिवाइड एंड दे मल्टीप्लाई एंड यू जस्ट नीड टू ऐड द फ्रेश मटेरियल दैट हैज बीन प्री प्रोसेस्ड. युवराज?
यस सर. एक्चुअली जस्ट लाइक हाउ द वे वी मेंशन अबाउट सॉलिड वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट, सो वुड इट बी पॉसिबल दैट वी कुड ऐड सम मोर पॉइंट्स लाइक ऑन
ऑन एडवांटेजेस.
नो, some more points about solid waste management.
On solid waste management.
So vermicompost is a bioconversion process basically. So it is used for solid waste management, and this bioconversion process use earthworms feed on the organic matter and to produce more and more earthworms, vermicompost, and vermicompost as products. Okay, like earthworms. There are many species of earthworms which are basically used in this, and vermicompost have been done for various waste, like animal waste are there, plant waste are there, pharmaceutical, food waste, sewage waste are also there. But the process, like if you are going to the process conditions during vermicompost are ranged around, there is a specific temperature, 60 to 67 degrees Celsius. And a particular pH is also required for it, that is around 6 to 8 pH, and moisture content should be managed in a proper basis. And vermicompost yields of 50 to 60%, 30 to 50% around, and for various organic waste, and the vermicompost. And vermi wash produce are rich in nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. That's it.
Okay. I had one more question for you. Can you highlight some specific types of worms that are specifically used?
Achha, so yeah, there are many types, like. I guess Aisnia entry and Lampito maurati, something like this, and Audrillus something, I don't exactly remember the names, like pronunciation is exactly.
Ishita, your question.
So,
Yeah, are you audible?
As Pradeep said, that mainly the, as we all know, that mainly earthworms are used in composting and all. Why only earthworms are used and why they are called as the nature's human? Can Pradeep, can you please just tell us?
Yeah, earthworms move through the soil and loosen and aerates the soil basically. They also help the water to reach the roots quickly. So, in other words, earthworms' excreta increases the fertility of the soil. And that is why basically earthworms are only used and they are also called nature's plowman or like farmer's friend in that sense.
I think the presentation, Tridib, that you have given was more of the textual part, and that is why the questions, they are based upon that only. It would have been really good if you have given a scientific presentation rather than a mere reading of some text part. What conditions are favorable for earthworms? This is again, Vivek, this is again the subject oriented question, has already been discussed in the class. It's there. What conditions are favorable for growth of earthworms and vermicomposting? So obviously they need to be taken well care of, the pH, the temperature, the moisture. Moisture is a crucial factor. They release some material from their body surfaces and it needs to be added up with the moisture so that they can have more penetration abilities going in depth into the 1 meter depth or a half meter depth of the height of the substrate that is being provided. So it's more of the textual part. Was not happy with the presentation, Tridev. I would give you another chance, but before that, students, I would request you all to give. When I have sent you an email, my question was that give your presentation on a research or review article with an understanding of the subject. Aapke subject ki understanding us presentation mein reflect honi chahiye. It's not that you are presenting the things that have been taught in the class that you can already access. You can ask anybody, but what new things we can learn out of it. So, Sam's presentation, though he had read major part of the portion, but when he came to presentation of the paper of the research article, it was more clear. I mean, more clear in the sense that he had actually given the presentation talking about the paper findings, talking about that how, I mean, there was just one figure in results. So with that, the emphasis, you can emphasize that what slide is being represented rather than putting up the text only and you are reading the text. It doesn't make any sense. These are just for your suggestions, for your improvements, ki aap logo ke presentation skills jo hain, wo aur increase ho. Talking more, having with few pictures would make more sense. So, just try to have these points in future presentations, jab bhi agli presentations hongi. But Tridev had already made me a request that he was not well, and I just considering that factor would give you another chance. But nonetheless, he just asked me that can I give it some other day, but I told him no. So there will be no change that will be entertained. So those who are having the presentation on Thursday, be prepared accordingly. Is it fine for all of you? I hope if there is any question, I can answer it. So fine, guys, I will stop here. Just in the last moment, I'll just take up the attendance. Adhish, thoda jaldi yaar apne camera.
Present, sir.
Camera on karte jana. Athoiba.
Present, sir.
Ishita, okay, done. Ayushi.
Present, sir.
Sam, it's done. Devanshi.
Present, sir.
Ishita, camera band kar do apna.
Janvi. Okay, sir.
Janvi, it's done. Okay. Manaswini.
Present, sir.
Namrata?
Present, sir.
Cannot see. Okay. Namrata?
Yes, sir. Present.
Nandini?
Present, sir.
Nehal? Rupal? Fine. Sahiba? Sanjana?
Present, sir.
Present, sir.
Shakti? Shivani? Present. Tanvi? Tridev? Tridev, it's done for you. Vivek?
Present, sir.
Present, sir.
And you, Raj?
Present, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, guys.